Morning, Extreme Kids. I'm so glad you're joining us again this week for week two of We Are the Church. This week in Acts, we're going to go through the first part of chapter six, and I'm so excited. So just get up and get ready and stretch for worship, because afterwards, we're going to get right to it.
I can search around forever. I'd be looking for no reason. When I have you, there's nothing missing. When it's just me, I'm incomplete. Every part of you is what I need. You're all I've got, my everything. There's no me without.
From the depths you have raised me to a height I have never seen. Oh, you saw what I could be, and now I know I'll never be the same. Love is called my name. Alive and
Following is a message filmed by Kyle, because there were no kids' lesson videos on YouTube. Watch at your own risk. So after the church had been continuing to grow, this is what happened with the disciples. Starting from Acts 6, verse 1. In those days when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food.
So, why aren't you feeding our widows? You told us you'd be feeding our widows. They're hungry. What good are you? We started the church. We said we would feed the widows and the orphans, and you're not feeding our widows. What are you doing? What are you doing?
Yeah, we just so hungry. We're so hungry. Give us the food.
So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word."
All right, so listen, this is what we're going to do. We said we'd give out food. We're going to give out food. But we all know that we ain't got time to give out the food. So this is what we're going to do. I said we should pick 7 guys who go wait these tables, who go and take care of the food for us because we got other things to do, right? Come on, Peter, preach it. We're out here saving people, performing miracles. I don't see none of you doing that. Amen. So anyway, we're going to save these people, and then we're going to put these 7 guys to take care of the tables, take care of these widows. How does that sound, everybody? Sound good? That sound good?
This proposal pleased the whole group.
Yeah. That makes sense. I mean, I don't see why we didn't do that to begin with, so yeah, I'm game.
Yeah, that works for me. I just want food. So if y'all can give me something to eat, then yeah, I'm okay with it. I don't care who gives it to me. I just want the food.
All right. So now we're making progress. So I'm going to tell you who we picked, all right? So the 12 of us got together, and this is who we chose. We got 7 guys for you. You ready?
They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Also Philip. Procurus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. And because of what the disciples did, the number of people in the church continued to multiply.
All right, so I hope you enjoyed my funny video, It was weird making it because literally there were no kids lesson videos about choosing the seven. So, hope it made sense and you got the gist of what happened. But before we get into that, just talk a little bit about last week. We just talked about Pentecost and we talked about what it meant that the Holy Spirit came and filled up the disciples. So now, moving to where we are, and we skipped a little bit. We went from chapter 2 to now chapter 6. The in-between part is all of this growth and development of the church. Like, there's people coming in and the disciples are super busy, just filled with tons of stuff to do because there's so many people coming up and filling this church, and there's people being saved and healed and baptized, and it's really amazing. But here we are at the next critical step in the development of the church, right? The next big important part of what makes us a church. And that's the fact that the disciples got a little burnt out. Now, what does that mean to get burnt out? It means that you're doing too much and you're getting tired and you're not able to keep up with everything anymore. And if you are an adult, and you already know what this means, and if you are an adult in ministry, like me, or Dennis, or Hannah, you definitely know what this means. So, we look at the disciples who are tired, who are just done. They've been doing a lot, and it's been great, and it's God's work, and they want to keep doing more of it, but they can't keep up with what they need to do. And part of this, unfortunately, meant that some people weren't getting what they need. We talked a little bit in the video, because I read the scripture straight through, the Hellenistic Jews and the Hellenistic Jews' widows were not getting fed. Now the Hellenistic Jews, that's a big word, and you're like, I don't know what that means, so I'll move on. But the Hellenistic Jews were pretty much just people who belonged to Greece, right? The Hebraic Jews were the Israelites. They were people who grew up in Israelite culture. They spoke Hebrew. They went through different things. The Hellenistic Jews were Jewish people from Greece. They had Greek culture. They spoke in Greek. They had a completely different way of life. And we were starting to notice that the traditional Jewish people, the Israelites, were getting taken care of, but not the Greek Jewish people. That's not okay. In fact, part of the issues we have today is some people getting treated better than other people. And it's not to say the disciples did that on purpose, but it's to say that they just couldn't do it all. There was too many people. I mean, if you think about everything that the disciples had to do, walking around and waiting tables, even though that was one of the foundations of the church, was helping widows and orphans, they couldn't do it. They couldn't keep up. They had other things they were doing. They were preaching to masses. They were saving people. They were baptizing people, the things that Jesus commanded. They couldn't keep up with waiting tables. So what did they do? They chose people to take up those responsibilities. They chose people to help them out. That is a key part of what makes us the church. Because yes, we become a church because we are a group of believers who are filled with the Holy Spirit. But the next step from that is discipleship. Is picking leaders, picking disciples to pick up where you can't. Like myself, I'm one person. I can do a lot of things, sure, but I can only be in one place at once. If you came in on a Sunday and there were no other volunteers here, I would not be able to watch all of the kids at once. You kidding me? I can be in the K-5 room or the pre-K room or the toddler room or the infant room or check-in. I can do any of those things, but I can't do them at the same time. So what do you need? You need people who can be in those rooms for you, right? Like, we have amazing volunteers like Karen and Helen and Christina and Danny and Mark and many other people who are in those places because I can't be. In the same way, the disciples recognized that if they can't wait the tables, if they can't take care of the widows of the Hellenistic Jews, then other people have to do it. So, we learn one important lesson, and it's that we can't do it all ourselves. It's that we need to ask for help. You see, the church is here to support one another. That's a foundation of the church. Our first foundation is that we're filled with the Holy Spirit. Our second foundation is that we are filled here together to support one another. We are one body in Christ. If you need something, that's what we're here for. That's our whole purpose, right? Like we said last week, the purpose of the church is to feed people, to take care of people, to help them through their tough issues, to teach them about Jesus, to do all of these amazing things. But we also need to take care of each other. That's a part of the church. We can't do anything else if we're not helping each other. So the lesson here is that to ask for help, to make disciples, to make friends. That's pretty simple, isn't it? Pretty short chapter and a pretty simple lesson. Make friends. Be nice to people. Support one another. And we don't only see this here. We can take this way back into the book of Exodus when Moses and all of the Israelites first fled Egypt. So this is the beginning of the Bible, right? This is way, 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 way back with Moses. And that was the first church with Moses and the Israelites, the tabernacle. And Moses was doing it all himself. And this is what Moses' father-in-law said to him. So we look at this, and it's in Exodus 18, verses 17 and 18. I would back up and put it here, but it's way too big. So instead, I'm going to back up even further and fill up the entire screen. You can see my head, though. It's okay. And it says, Moses' father-in-law replied, "What you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you will only wear yourselves out. The work is too heavy for you. You cannot handle it alone." So, there we have it. Moses' father-in-law was telling Moses, because Moses was doing everything himself, to stop. It's not good for anyone. It's not good for him. It's not good for the people that he's leading. And that's the message for us. What we're doing, we cannot do alone. No matter what it is, whether it's your everyday life or a specific job or role that you're trying to fill, you can't do it alone. You need people around you to support you. Moses learned that, and the disciples learned it. So can we. It's an important step of the church. We're not a church if we can't empower people to step up and do more. I mean, geez, if I never empowered you guys to do more, the kids' ministry would just be over after a generation. Because why? There would be nobody to run it, nobody to lead it, nobody to volunteer. We're reliant upon making more disciples, making more leaders. So, here's your takeaway. Surround yourself with people that will support you. Make sure you're choosing your friends wisely. Make sure you're making good decisions. Make sure you're asking for help when you need it. Make sure you're listening to advice from people who know what to do. And if you don't have that, find that. Your parents will help you. I'll help you. Your friends, the people who come to this church with you, are great people to have around you. That's your church. So make friends, build stronger connections. You'll find that life is so much easier when you do. Because after this, because they made those seven new disciples, the church continued to grow substantially. Those seven made disciples of their own, who made disciples of their own, and as the church got bigger and bigger and bigger, there was no shortage of people to take care of the widows. There was no shortage of people to help out. And as your life gets bigger, as your life gets more complex, as it gets harder, as things go crazy, because they will, that's life, you're going to need people around to support you. So make those connections now. Get used to asking for help. All right, I'm going to pray. Father God, thank you for gathering us here. Lord, thank you that you send people to help us. Thank you that you encourage us to be a community, God, that it's not just a relationship with you, but it's a relationship with each other as well. Father God, I pray that you would help us to surround ourselves with people that are good for us, people that will help us make the right decisions and get closer to you. God, I pray that our kids' church and our church as a whole will just be a stronger community. That Holy Spirit, you fill us up, God, but that you would also empower us to be closer to one another and close the gaps where there are one. We love you, Jesus. Amen. All right, we're going to go into worship, and then I'll hit you with the challenge. But wait, there's also something cool coming up, so stay tuned.
When silence falls, I hear you call. In the secret place, you still my soul with quiet joy, and I'm wide awake. In the middle of the night, I look up to the sky. I can hear you singing over me through the fire and the flood. I know that I am loved. I can hear you singing over me, yeah. You spoke the earth with just one word, and you hold my heart.
Yeah.
All right, so challenges this week. Only a couple this time, I promise. The first one, obviously, memorize Exodus 18, verses 17 and 18. Second one is the same challenge from last week about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Again, I will put them right here for you. If you don't know what they are, look them up. But if you haven't done it already, just think about what gifts you might want to ask from the Holy Spirit. Very simple. Either identify the ones that you have now, or think about the ones that you want, and pray about it. If you have done this challenge already, you can either leave it where it is, you can keep praying for it, or you can think about it, and you can think about how God might be using that in you already. For an example, one of our friends last week talked about the gift of healing, and that she wanted it because she wanted to make people feel better. She wanted to heal people from being hurt emotionally. Now think about it. Is there a way in your life now where you help people feel better? Where you lift up their spirits? And is there a way that you can start to work on that gift and put it into action? So if you haven't done it, look at the gifts of the Holy Spirit and think about which one you might want. And if you have done the challenge, take it a step further. And how can you put that gift into action? Last challenge, so number three. Make a list of friends that you have that are good for you. It doesn't have to be a long list. You don't have to list out every person you've ever met, but make a list of friends, of people that are good for you, that are a good influence, that make you feel good. And then make another list. Now this one can definitely be short, like maybe even just like three people, but make a list of people that you want to get closer to, who you know will help you out, support you. And then get closer to them, reach out to them. Maybe have your mom send them a message to their mom. Maybe set up a phone call, like a Zoom call or a FaceTime or something. But make a plan to grow your friend list and make a group around you of people who are going to support you. So those are your challenges. Memorize the verses. Think about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Make a list of friends that you have and that you want. That's it. I'll see you guys next week, and stay safe out there. I miss you guys. Bye.